Hey folks, welcome back to Game Geeks. I'm your host, Kurt Weigel. Today's episode, we are reviewing the Paranet Papers for the Dresden Files role-playing game. I kind of need to point out here that this is for the full Fate version of the Dresden Files. This goes all the way back to the first two books that were published a couple of years ago. This is not for Fate Core, which is the more recent, streamlined, slimmed down version of Fate that's seen a lot of popularity pop up. So there are conversions out there. If you want to go out and find them, you're more than welcome to. They work fairly well, but this is written with the full version of Fate in mind. Now, this has been in progress for a while. One of the things I like about Evil Hat and their Dresden Files line is they do not feel the need to rush their products. It is what it is. It takes a while, but what you get are these really beautiful, well put together, extremely well produced, and well written books. One of the more charming conceits of the entire Dresden Files role-playing game line is that it is written in character, such that the characters from the books themselves are writing a game, and they're using this, and what you're looking at are their rules and their notes for it. So there are occasional sidebars and post-its, etc., from the character's point of view as the books are written. Now, this does contain significant spoilers for the later Dresden Files books. So, this is your spoiler alert. Feel free, if you want to avoid spoilers or you have not read anything up to changes, this is the time for you to go away. So, I'll give you a few moments to go away. Are they gone? Okay. This assumes you know what happened in Changes. That is, major events in Harry's life. The Red Court vampires are gone. He is the Winter Knight. He died and disappeared. This does not necessarily include material from Ghost Story, nor anything after that. So as far as the characters know, Harry is gone, and that is referenced a lot in this book. Almost to the point of distraction. One of the downsides to them taking their time and producing these is they're not necessarily very timely. For example, this contains material for a lot of the short stories that have come afterwards, information on the Formore, etc. But the problem is nothing from the two books that have come out since, or including Ghost Story. Nothing new on Capra Corpus. Nothing new on the infection of Maeve and Lily with the adversary, the outsiders problems, and certainly nothing from the latest book, Skin Games, which involved getting into Hades' vault, the thing in Harry's head, etc. But it's pretty good for what they bring you up to speed on in those terms, but that's really not what this book is about. What this book is about is presenting you with new settings and new options. I'm going to go through those settings individually before we get into some of the changes for the core books themselves. The new settings they give you are Las Vegas, especially Las Vegas in the wake of the destruction of the Red Court, Russia, which is honestly my least favorite of the sections, and I'll deal with why. The Neverglades, sort of the swampy Florida area. La Tierra Roja, which is Mexico and South America, again, in the wake of the destruction of the Red Court. The Ways Between, which is how to structure a game with going in and out of the Never Never. And then finally, some other stuff and bringing it up to speed with the rest of the Dresden books. So I'm going to kind of go through these in order. One of my favorites being Las Vegas. I've often thought Las Vegas would have been a great setting for the Dresden Files. The other one I would love to see, and Fred and company, if you're listening, please do New Orleans. For some reason, I just can't get my brain around what a New Orleans Dresden game would look like, but I'd love to see what you folks do with it. So Las Vegas, and the idea of it being written from someone who got essentially a genius loci of Las Vegas stuck in his head, and him just word vomiting out everything he knows about Las Vegas before he died. the fact that it is a city in transition, that the great supernatural force that held it together recently died because of the purge of the Red Court, and all of the factions now, everything is up for grabs, and the fact that mortals caught in the middle aren't necessarily in the best place. It gives you an idea for a significant amount of meta plot as well, in the form of some ancient evil horror that lies underneath Las Vegas that sort of empowers the master of Las Vegas to keep everyone else in line, and the fact that there's something that ancient evil horror is scared of as well that caused the destruction that now is Death Valley. So there's a lot of build in there, how the different casinos affect what's going on. Each one of the casinos is sort of the power basis of one of the significantly powerful supernatural factions, the White Court, the Fae, etc. One of the more interesting things that came out of this was the idea that there are old gods who hold power in Las Vegas. And I was really impressed that they did not go with the obvious. I thought you could look at Luxor and think some of the ancient Egyptian gods in power there. Instead, they went with another power basis, which is the cult of Ishtar ruling in parts of Las Vegas as well. I was impressed that they didn't take the easy route there. So, a buildup, places you can go or avoid, significant supernatural factions, people to either ally yourself with or fight. One of the things I liked was that no one really seems to be good or innocent, or the obvious good guys like Harry is in Chicago. In Las Vegas, everyone has an agenda and everyone's out to make something. Also, one of the ideas that was proposed was that casinos can make attacks against you where you have to defend with your resources. That somehow, no matter what you do, you manage to hemorrhage money while you're in Las Vegas. It's a darker setting than Chicago, which you could well imagine, but I think it holds up very nicely as its own setting. Now, shifting gears into Russia, the reason I didn't like the Russia chapter wasn't that it was poorly designed, not that at all, it's actually very well written, it's the fact that it is just post-revolutionary Russia in 1918 as your setting, and I think to truly use that as a setting, you would almost have to be a scholar of Russian history and Russian sociology in that era to get the most bang for your buck. And if you have a group of players that are scholars in that era of Russia and want to play a Dresden Files role-playing game, ladies and gentlemen, joygasm. This is the setting for you because I think it's beautifully, it's stocked, it gives you ideas on how to do it, beautiful, just fantastically well-built ideas, but I don't think I've ever played with a player who is a scholar of 1918 post-revolution Russia who would really dig this. And I think for my players, especially that I've worked with over the years, not just my current group, but groups in the past, it would sort of be this is interesting, but get on the anachronism choo-choo train. Whoop, whoop, lasers, here we come. The Neverglades was a fantastic application of the city builder, but used instead for small town. And the idea that you can do small towns in Dresden Files as easily as you can do big anonymous cities. I like the fact that the Fountain of Youth is the primary source of power there, and that everyone who lives in the area for as long as they do has the wizard's constitution stunt, even though it's kind of a not really, for free. Because when you live in the environment of the Fountain of Youth, people don't age the same. People's lives are extended. They heal better than they would normally. This isn't a supernatural recovery or inhuman recovery like you see in the game. It's just you live long enough, your shit heals. So it's really well set up in terms of the idea of going there. I could see playing in the Neverglades maybe even a little bit easier than playing in Las Vegas because I get small town Southern. I get the fact that you live in an environment that's heavily wet and gators everywhere. I mean, for God's sake, you've got a character who's a weird gator. And if that doesn't just make you go for the possibilities, then you probably don't need to be playing this game. There's also a weird bloodhound mixed in there as well. Again, the fall of the Red Court is pervasive in this area as well. not quite as much as you would see into the next one, which is La Tierra Roja. Now, Mexico and South America were extremely heavily dominated under the thumb of the Red Court. Now that Harry took care of that pesky little problem going into the next series, then it is all up for grabs in that area now. And supernatural forces are flooding in to try to take over that region. One of the more chilling, almost side notes that came out of this was, how did the Lords of Elder Night really get their power? They were really ancient Red Court sorceress beings, but for an incredibly devastatingly powerful entity like Lia, the Lianxi, second only to Mab herself, more powerful than the Winter Ladies, to be able to just take on a couple of them, and she could kill them, but it occupied her for a while. That kind of gives you an idea of the power scale that the Lords of Outer Night had. How did they get that power? It gives you ideas for that there, and the fact that now that they're no longer draining these semi-divine beings, that power is now up for grabs again. There's a lot to read in here, and you almost have to read between the lines to seriously get ideas for a campaign. This is more set up to be a, not just in a city, but in a region, almost a spy thriller campaign for the Dresden Files. I think it would work very nicely there. And if you are looking for ways to overlap that with, say, Night's Black Agents, different system, and vampires are still around there, but there are a lot of ideas for the intermix there if you're looking for it. The Ways Between presents you with a great idea for a campaign that I don't know that I would ever really run, but it gives you almost a travelogue of what you can see in the Never Never and where you pop out in the world as a result. I think it works very nicely. Again, I can't see myself ever running a campaign in that sort of setting, but it gives you options aplenty if that's what you're looking to do. Particularly interesting is that there are places that are almost clearinghouses or safe houses for popping in and out of the Never Never, and places to hide from things that are still chasing you. Spellcasting, it sort of opens up other avenues there, especially in the idea of sponsored magic. It gives you more options for Soulfire, because it got more defined as it went later on. How magic works in the Never Never, expanded rules for thaumaturgy and for evocations. And one thing I particularly liked was the idea of it limits what you can do with sponsored magic, because let's face it, someone's not just giving you this power out of the kindness of their hearts. No, the beings that can grant these sorts of powers want something in return. Another nice thing that came out of this was the idea of mental toughness, which is how really powerful wizards can throw around the magic that they do without incurring significant debt. Especially in Changes, we saw some elder magi, both the good guys and the bad guys, throwing around power on the level that Harry can't do. And Harry is a very well-versed combat wizard. So their rationale for that was this sort of idea of supernatural mental fortitude, where you can basically, instead of gaining a point of mental stress every time you do a spell, you gain certain levels of immunity to that, and you can just lay things low without any significant detriment to you, only really gaining that when you go to do the cool stuff. And let's face it, when you're in an open magic system, like you see in the Dresden Files, if you're not regularly going for the cool, make your spell on the fly, then you probably shouldn't be playing a wizard, in my opinion. That was one of the best things I found when I played this game, was I was just throwing together these ideas on the fly, almost never used my rote spells, but I like the idea of really creative, what can I do to screw up the GM's plan with this spell? Sorry, Jordan. From there, an expansion on the monsters that you run into, special attention paid to the Formor, because they are sort of the new bad guys that were introduced in this area. I like the fact that Binder gets a little attention, because I love to hate him, and then you start to like him more in Skin Game. finally, expansion on characters that we've met and new characters from the books themselves that are introduced here. Should you get this book, if you like the Dresden Files role-playing game and you're looking for new city ideas, if you're not creative enough, like me, to use their city setting to build your own ideal version of, I don't know, San Francisco or New Orleans, I'm a country boy at heart, ladies and gentlemen. That's why the Neverglades applied to me as much as they did. I would love to build New Orleans in this, but I feel like I just don't know enough about the city. Las Vegas is wonderful. Bam, there you go. The Neverglades, historical Russia, if that floats your boat, popping in and out of the Never Never as a campaign idea, all sorts of great stuff contained in this for you. For Game Geeks, I'm your host, Kurt Weigel. Good day and good gaming.